In this video, you're gonna learn how to rank videos on the first page of YouTube. Just like this video I recently published, I optimized this video for the search term church lobby, and within a week, the video was showing up on the first page of YouTube search results for that keyword. Well, hey there, I'm Brady Shearer, the CEO of Pro Church Tools and the creator of Nucleus, and maybe you've heard this said before, YouTube is the second largest search engine in the world. Not only that though, YouTube's also actually the second most popular website in the world. At the time of this recording, even more popular than Facebook. Crazy, right? And one of the reasons that YouTube is so popular is that YouTube, unlike Facebook, is a search engine. Sure, you can sign up for an account and log into your profile, but that's not a requirement to use the platform. And this means that anyone, anywhere, can watch and search for videos on YouTube, and your videos can be indexed in search to be found organically by people all around the world 24/7. Nevertheless, I want to spend the time we have together in this video talking about how to use YouTube, not why it's so awesome. And so here's the bottom line. For your church to be successful on YouTube, you first need to ask yourself the following question. Are we using YouTube as a search engine, or are we using YouTube for storage? What do I mean by that? Well, I mean that if all you're doing is uploading your sermons to YouTube and hoping that they'll be discovered, you're not using YouTube as a search engine the way that it was meant to be used. You're using it as your own free personal storage platform. And hey, don't get me wrong, there's nothing bad about that, but don't be surprised if your views and subscribers stay where they are if this is all that you're doing, because if you're not using YouTube the way users are actually using YouTube, you're not bringing value to anyone. And if you can't first bring value to a person on YouTube, don't expect them to bring value to you through a view, subscribe, or a thumbs up. Now, at this point, you might be wondering, but Brady, some of the most successful churches in the world on YouTube, like Elevation Church, just published their sermons. Why can't we do the same thing, right? Well, funnily enough, the most popular YouTube video that I've ever published is a video called Why You Should Never Copy Elevation Church. And the thesis of the video is very simple. 90% of all American churches are 350 people or fewer in average attendance. So as a baseline, Elevation Church is likely 50 times to 100 times larger than you are as a church. And looking at the tactics of a church that is that different from you in terms of infrastructure and just blindly copying those tactics, that's an easy way to lose. Now, with that being said, you can learn from a unicorn church like Elevation by studying their strategy, just don't copy their tactics. And here's what I mean by that. Elevation has invested a ton of resources into their YouTube channel. Why? Well, because they recognize how much attention YouTube has. And that goes back to what we talked about earlier with YouTube being the second most visited website in the world. Elevation is investing a bunch of resources into YouTube. That's the strategy. And that is something your church can learn from. But how is Elevation doing it? Well, for the most part, they're just posting their sermons. That's the tactic. That's the part you cannot copy. And here's why. Take a look at this search data. This comes directly from a tool called keywordtool.io, and the data you're seeing is YouTube search volume. So let's pull out a couple of examples. The search term Stephen Furtick sermons gets almost 60,000 monthly searches on YouTube within America. And yes, this is America only every single month. The keyword Elevation Church sermons gets more than 20,000 monthly searches. Add in some of the more long-tail keywords and you can see that unique users in America only search specifically for Elevation and Furtick sermons more than 100,000 times each month. And this is why you, Grace Church Vacaville, can't copy the tactics of Elevation. Study the strategy, yes. Copy the tactics, no. YouTube is a search engine. It's a search engine. More than 100,000 people are searching for the sermons of Stephen Furtick every single month, so Elevation has the luxury of just being able to upload their messages and have them watched and found, also because they have more than 500,000 subscribers on their channel as well. So what does this mean for you? Simply put, the first step to succeeding on YouTube is understanding user behavior and what people are looking for to begin with. YouTube is a search engine. And if you or your pastor have a huge following and are receiving tens of thousands of monthly searches for your messages, then hey, maybe you can succeed just by uploading your messages to YouTube. But if you're like the rest of us, you'll need to take a different approach. So let's learn how to do that. Remember, the reason a Stephen Furtick sermon is so popular on YouTube is because people are searching for him already and his messages. For you and your church to succeed on YouTube, you need to take a similar approach, except no one is searching for you probably. And hey, that's okay, because the question remains, what are users searching for? Now, the first thing I do is I go to keywordtool.io, a tool that I mentioned earlier. This tool helps me discover keywords search volume, so I can uncover the types of things that people are already looking for on YouTube. And once I know what they're looking for, then I can make videos on those exact topics. So one keyword that I uncovered recently was the keyword church lobby. It gets about 3,500 monthly searches on YouTube in America, which made it a great candidate for a potential video. Because in my experience, you want to look for keywords with a search volume of between 1,000 and 100,000. Any less than 1,000, and there may not be enough people searching for that term to justify making a video. Any more than 100,000 unique monthly searches, and the term is likely so popular that you'll struggle to get noticed. Another data point to pay attention to here is the competition column. This metric is measured from 0 to 1. The competition analysis for the keyword church lobby is set at 0.08, so that's very low, meaning I have a great chance for ranking high for this keyword simply because the competition is already pretty low. So that's an example of how I did keyword research for my Pro Church Tools channel recently. And what about your church? Well, it's unlikely that making a video based on the church lobby would make any sense for you, but here's a great example of a video your church could do. A video based on the keyword Bible translation. The keyword Bible translation receives more than 70,000 unique monthly searches on YouTube within America. Competition is low, right around 0.1, making this keyword a perfect candidate for a video. Just think about that for a moment. Tens of thousands of people are searching every single month for the keyword Bible translation, likely with the intentions of better understanding scripture. They're thinking, what's the best version? How can I make sure my version is accurate? What are the differences between different translations? These are the questions that need answers. And who can help with this? The church, of course. Sadly, not a single church shows up on the first page right now for this result. Why? Why are there no churches on the first page here? In fact, it took me all the way to the 26th position to find a pastor of a church in the search results. Who was it? Mark Driscoll. The video was 2 years old. And to prove a point, I did this exact same thing with a number of other search terms. Bible version, Bible study. Heck, I searched for the term how to study the Bible and not a single church showed up. What did show up? Well, I found a Joyce Meyer video, but it wasn't posted by Joyce or her team. It was on someone's personal channel. It was literally a 4:3 aspect ratio video ripped from television and uploaded to YouTube, probably at least 10 years old. I found a video from Charles Stanley, again, someone's personal channel ripped from TV. And I found a video from R.C. Sproul, again, 4:3 aspect ratio from 13 years ago. So what's the bottom line? Every month in America, 88,000 unique individuals search on YouTube how to study the Bible, and within the first 50 results, not a single pastor or church has made a YouTube video answering that question. The second largest search engine in the world, the second most popular website in the world, 95% of Gen Z uses this platform, 50% of Gen Z say they can't live without it, and the best we've got are 10-year-old messages made for television, bootlegged, and uploaded. If you follow any of my work at all, you've likely heard me say that we're living through the biggest communication shift in 500 years. Every industry is being disrupted, and our churches are not immune to these changes. And I cannot think of a better example than this. Tens of thousands of people using new mediums, searching for answers about God and the Bible and the church, is quite literally silent. Why? Well, because we're still demanding people to come to us on a Sunday morning. Come to our building, and we'll answer your question. Come to our service, and you can find what you need. Instead of going into the world, we're demanding the world comes to us. It's backwards. And it's putting our churches in vulnerable positions for the next decade. And it's not serving our cities or communities well. Here's something especially interesting. When I was doing research on the keyword, how to study the Bible, while I did not come across any churches or pastors, I did come across a friend of mine, Justin Koo, known online as That Christian Vlogger. He made a video called How to Study the Bible for Beginners. It ranks number one in the world for that keyword. It's got more than 100,000 views, more than 300 comments almost. I also found videos from three other channels that I was unfamiliar with, videos on how to study the Bible from women under 30 years of age named Jacqueline, Jordan, and Samantha. And that really encouraged me because even if churches are unwilling to invest resources into world-changing platforms like YouTube, young people are willing to do it and on their own time, it seems. So with all that being said, if at this point you are inspired to begin using YouTube the way it's meant to be used, to answer questions that people are searching for, recognizing that YouTube is a search engine, I want to show you the anatomy of a video that ranks on the first page of YouTube search results. The first step like we said, it's finding the right keyword. Using YouTube's autofill feature for free, you can find keywords, or you can use a tool like keywordtool.io. And again, look for keywords with a search volume between 1,000 and 100,000, and the lower the competition, the better. Let's use the keyword Bible translation as our example. The next step is to begin writing the video, so let's start with the title. Of course, the most important thing to do is make sure you include your keyword in the title of your video, and the earlier you place it in the title, the better. So an example for this video title could be the three best Bible translations that are accurate and easy to read. Next comes your video's intro. YouTube has come out and said that the majority of users will decide whether or not to watch your video within the first 15 seconds. So it's the first 15 seconds of the video that are the most important. And this is where you'll either win or lose your audience. So it's important that you explicitly state what a viewer will gain from watching your video. To use our Bible translation keyword as an example, maybe you write an intro that goes a little something like this. In this video, you're going to learn about the three best Bible translations. These translations are not only among the most accurate, but they're also easy to read and understand, especially for beginners. So, that intro only took about 5 seconds, but it made a value proposition to our potential viewer. Here I explicitly said to them what to expect from the video, and now it's up to them on whether or not they decide they want that. And from there, it's time to write out and plan out the rest of your video. And here I really want you to pay attention to the overall length. One of the most important metrics that YouTube pays attention to when it ranks videos is overall watch time. Why does YouTube care about this? Well, simply put, the longer someone watches a video, the longer they stay on YouTube, the more likely they are to see and respond to ads, the more money YouTube makes. And a common misconception that I once believed myself is that shorter videos are better. I used to keep my videos around 4 minutes each, but now I aim for 10 minutes or longer with each of my videos because I want to boost my overall channel and video watch time. What's the easiest way to increase watch time? Well, make a longer video. Of course, this will require extra work on your part because you can't just make a longer video for the sake of it. It needs to be good, but this increase in length will increase your likelihood of ranking on the first page of YouTube. And we don't stop there because now we need to prepare our video's talk shocks. Now you're surely wondering, Brady, what in the world is a talk shock? Well, if your videos are anything like mine, they involve a lot of talking head, kind of like this video. And it can be tough for your viewer to just sit and watch a person talk for a long time, so it's important to intentionally place what I like to call talk shocks at various intervals throughout your video. Basically, a talk shock is anything that shocks your viewer back to paying attention and breaks up the monotony of just plain old talking. So here's an example we used in my church lobby video. I'm talking about church lobbies, blah, 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 and then we include a talk shock. Of course, maybe you don't call this structure the welcome desk. Maybe you call it
the info kiosk,
the connection center,
the next steps tent,
the information station,
whatever you call it. Talk shocks are great ways to increase watch time and attention within your videos. And don't be afraid to have some fun with them either. Now, let's talk about your video's thumbnail. There are three elements to a great thumbnail. Those three elements are as follows: a big photo of a person's face, bright colors, and big text. Here's an example. This is the photo we used as the thumbnail for the church lobby video, and within the top three search results for the term church lobby, look how much this thumbnail stands out compared to the other videos above and below it. Now, why is a photo of a human face so important? Well, let's look to the data. Georgia Institute of Technology and Yahoo Labs researchers looked at 1.1 million photos on Instagram, and they found that pictures with human faces were 38% more likely to receive likes than photos with no faces, and they were also 32% more likely to attract comments. And this study was one of the first to examine how photos with faces drive engagement on large-scale sharing communities like Instagram or YouTube. Simply stated, we humans are a social species, and we're more likely to be attracted to another human's face than virtually anything else, especially when it's a smiling, happy face. So you need these in your thumbnails. Next up, bright colors. Bright colors are attention-grabbing, and they stand out, especially when lined up next to other video thumbnails. And this is a huge signal that YouTube looks at when ranking its videos. Does your video earn a higher click-through rate than other videos with similar search terms? If it does, YouTube is likely to rank your video higher. Bright colors and thumbnails do wonders in this respect. Finally, thumbnails with big, bold text perform great because they reinforce what the video is about. If someone searches for church lobby and sees the thumbnail with the text Super Church Lobby Kiosk, they can immediately respond and say, yes, this video is for me, or no, it's not. And again, this helps with click-through rate and watch time, two of the most important ranking signals that YouTube pays attention to. So again, those three thumbnail factors are big smiling face, bright colors, big text. You know who else follows this formula? Elevation. Check out these thumbnails from their YouTube channel. They have each of those three elements present in every single one of them. And as a side note, this goes back to studying strategies versus copying tactics. It wouldn't be smart to look at how Elevation does their thumbnails and simply copy what they're doing without understanding why. But once you understand the science of human faces in photos and the ranking signals of click-through and watch time that YouTube is paying attention to, once you've studied the strategy, you can understand why another channel or church is doing what they're doing, and you can decide on how to implement that strategy yourself. Okay, so to summarize to this point, we've got the video content based on a keyword people are actually searching for. We've got our video title, length, thumbnail. Honestly, if this is all you did, you'd be in great shape. But let's keep optimizing and take it even one step further. Now that you're ready to publish your video, let's make sure we add a great description. Here are some guidelines to follow. Put your keyword in the first paragraph of the description. Make sure your description is 150 words or longer. In the case of my church lobby video, the description turned out being 287 words. Make sure the copy is conversational in nature and include some helpful links at the bottom. Now that our description is written, let's add some tags. Make sure your target keyword is always the very first tag, and then fill in the remaining tags with similar long tail keywords and related keywords. And don't confuse YouTube here by throwing in random keywords you think will rank high. Stay related to the video. You can use a free tool like TagsTube to find tags related to your keyword. I personally prefer vidIQ Boost for this task, but that is a paid tool. After your tags are added to the video, it's time to add a comment and pin it to the top of the comments section. Now, this is a little weird, but you've likely noticed this behavior in your own life. We as humans always go straight to the comments. Now, that's why all the popcorn comment GIFs exist. Sure, the video or content itself, it's great. But what are people saying in the comments? That's what we really want to know. Recognizing this behavior, I'll always publish a comment before I actually publish my video. And this is something you can do in YouTube. And I'll use this comment basically to ask a question. By asking a question, I'll elicit more comments on my video, which again is a great signal to YouTube's algorithm. And I'll make sure my comment is the first seen by viewers by pinning it to the top of the comments section. Next up, I'll add an end card to my videos. You can do this directly within the YouTube interface. I'll simply link to another video of mine and present a subscribe box for users to click. Here's the bottom line. If a viewer has watched your video all the way to the end, it's probably because they liked it, and there's a high probability that they would want more. So here, link to another video of yours that's related and give them the chance to subscribe. I'll also say this explicitly in every video. I'll say, hey, like this video, give it a thumbs up, and subscribe to my channel. Finally, the last thing I'll do is share my new YouTube video on Facebook and Twitter, social signals again for the algorithm, and I'll make sure to heart and respond to every single comment I receive on my video, at least within the first week, to make sure that conversation is being stimulated. Okay, that's a lot of stuff. So to summarize, find a keyword with a monthly search volume between 1,000 and 100,000 and create a video that answers the questions users are asking concerning this keyword. Give it a great title, focused on the first 15 seconds of the video where the majority of users can drop off. Aim to make the length 10 minutes or longer. Include talk shocks to reduce monotony. Create a thumbnail with a big smiling face of the person in the video with bright colors and big bold text. Add your description, tags, pinned comment, end card, and then share the video on social and respond to every comment with a reply and heart within the first week. Here's the deal with all of this stuff. It can seem tedious and a lot of work. I said a lot of things, as I tend to do, but this is a formula that works. I followed this exact formula myself, and within the first week was ranking in the top three for my targeted keyword. And the best news? That video is gonna be there for years. I put the work in up front, and now I can reap the rewards for years and years afterwards on autopilot. Churches need to be doing this. Create a video using this process every week for a year, and you'll have 50 videos on your channel. The mission of your church is to help people love God, love others, and make disciples. Every day, tens of millions of people are on YouTube with millions looking for answers to questions that our churches can answer. Let's not be silent. Go where the people are. Stop demanding they come to you. Build a following online using this formula. Add a Patreon so you can earn some money for the church and it can become an extra source of revenue. And go seize the 167 hours beyond your Sunday service. No other generation in history has had this ability. We do. So let's not squander it.